Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Mr. John Tory.
Thank you, Chief, very much. I hope my microphone's working. I'll just sit here so I can plant myself where I'm supposed to be. And Chief, thank you very much for those words of introduction. It was my pleasure to have as my dinner companion, Chief Maneg from Beausoleil Island, and he was telling me all about all of what they were doing and all the different things that were happening, and I thought to myself, my goodness, he's running things in such a business-like way there. So I said to him, is it kind of like being the mayor? And I, of course, was acting a little dumb about the role of a chief, and he said, well, you know, in some respects it's like that, yes. And so I was thinking to myself that there's probably a job we could have him doing over at the City Hall on Queen Street, but never mind. It is my pleasure to introduce the people who are going to be taking part in this dialogue over the next period of time. And may I say what a pleasure it was for me to be invited to come and do this. And I walked in the room tonight. I just finished being on the air at 7 o'clock. And I walked in and listened to the Grand Chief speaking, and just the whole tone of the event from walking in the room, and you'd been here for a little while before I was able to be here, is so constructive and so positive, and I think it's just the kind of thing I hope we could do over and over again, because I think it's so necessary, and I just say thank you to all of you for being here and for the initiation that was taken at making this kind of event happen. May I introduce the three people and maybe ask them to come up as they're introduced to take part in the discussion here. And they all are not in any need of introduction, so I'll be very brief in first introducing Grand Council Chief Patrick Madahbee. He has more political experience than the other two, who will tell you what experienced politicians they are, I'm sure, but he does. That's a fact. 30 years experience in the First Nations political arena, 17 years as chief of his own home community on Manitoulin Island, somebody who, of course, is well-versed in all aspects of First Nations politics and business, is somebody who brings a wealth of knowledge to his current position. And we please welcome Grand Council Chief Patrick Madahbee.
After 40 years.
Well, sorry, we just added another 10 years to his experience surplus over the other two, no disrespect to them at all, but it's 40 years. Here's another man who truly needs no introduction, and that is the Right Honourable Paul Martin, the former Prime Minister of Canada, former minister in the federal government. Welcome, sir. I don't need to tell you that this is a man who, you know, it's one thing to show leadership when you're in public office because it's part of your responsibilities, but I think the measure of this man and his interest in Aboriginal issues may be better measured by the fact that after he was Prime Minister of Canada and remained as a Member of Parliament, what did he concern himself with? Aboriginal issues. As a private citizen, after he left Parliament, what does he continue to concern himself with? Aboriginal issues. So this is somebody who, you know, is very sincere and genuine, of course, in his commitment to helping to address and bring attention to these issues. And I'm going to get in some trouble with some conservative somewhere for saying this, but the bottom line is it's just the truth, and you never get in trouble for telling the truth. He's just a decent man and somebody that we can all be proud of. My good friend, Premier Davis, for whom I worked as Chief of Staff, would say he's a very good man, just slightly politically misguided. And the same could be said of David Zimmer. The Honourable David Zimmer is Ontario's Minister of Aboriginal Affairs. I've known David for a long time, and David is a person who was deeply committed to public housing and his role with the Toronto Community Housing Corporation. He was then elected to the provincial legislature. He was, as well as a private citizen, someone who was deeply committed and one of the original kind of advocates on behalf of people with Alzheimer's in our community. He has been for some time now, since 2003, a member of provincial parliament and more recently Minister of Aboriginal Affairs. Again, a decent man, if not slightly politically misguided. Anybody who takes offense at my joking reference to people being politically misguided, I'm a talk show host now, I can say whatever I want. So, gentlemen, we're just going to have an informal discussion here, and I hope that while I'll direct the questions to people as we start, that I will call on each of you to comment, and I hope you'll feel free to pick up and comment on these things as you wish. The first question is to you, Chief, and it's interesting because even last week, Alan Gregg, some of you will know, embarked on a very interesting initiative. I think you were involved in helping Prime Minister to put it out, and he wanted to have the story of Tecumseh told to a broader number of Canadians, both in respect of who he was as a Canadian, but also as a bit of an education with respect to some of what happened to the Aboriginal peoples and some of the dealings they had in those days. And he got a number of us to use our Twitter accounts to send out notice of a paper he'd written on this subject. And in fact, it was interesting because it then caused the paper to be downloaded by people who I hope read it 100,000 times. But it was interesting because in the paper, even the story of Tecumseh portrayed him as what he was a fierce warrior. But sometimes the problem is, I think, even in this day and age, that First Nations people are depicted as you know, either pitiful victims or as kind of savage warriors. And one of the things that we wanted to have you bring out is to talk a little bit about what First Nations people are accomplishing today, what are some of the barriers that stand in the way of them accomplishing even more by way of economic self-sufficiency today as we sit here in 2013 and not talk about history but talk about modern day reality.
Well, thank you, and I left my savage warrior costume outside today. You know, as Anishinaabe people, we're human beings. We have the same desires and wants as the rest of Canadians are trying to strive for in terms of the betterment of their personal families, their community, and the nation. So we want economic sustainability. We want good governance. We want to have our languages, our culture, our social fabric of our communities remain intact. You know, we've been a resilient people. We've endured many. I call them experiments. The residential school era. Go even back further in history, the cold water experiment where they tried to turn us into farmers. You know, we have existed as a resilient people on this land for many, many years. We know the land well. So to that end, our aspirations, as First Nations people, are to build our communities. Our aspirations are to, have well-educated people. Our aspirations include, having sustainable employment opportunities made available so that our people can prosper just like everyone else is doing in this great land. So, when you say, what is our vision, how do we see ourselves being placed in the whole economic fabric of this country? I think we feel very confident that we've been placed in positions there where when we've had services taken over by our people that were normally delivered by outside jurisdictions, we've managed to do the job better and do a $1,000 job with $200 and get a better outcome. So I feel very confident in our people.
So just before I move to get a comment from Prime Minister Martin on this, what if you had to sort of name, one or two, but the barriers that stand mm-hmm. in the way of having that experience you just talked about repeated over and over again, where you can do a quality job and reach the aspirations or achieve the aspirations that you have for your kids, just like everybody else does in this room, what are the barriers?
It's very clear jurisdiction is the biggest issue, I think. We have, there was supposed to have been a follow-up meeting to the constitutional talks in 1982 with First Nations that would sort out what's federal jurisdiction, what's provincial jurisdiction, what's First Nations jurisdiction, where there may be areas of shared jurisdiction. We got bounced off the constitutional table by separatism and a whole number of other issues. And that issue prevails in every issue we do, whether it's in education, whether it's in economic development, whether it's in social issues we have. We're always battling the competing jurisdictions of whose responsibility it is. At the end of the day, it's our responsibility. We have to empower our people. We have to get the skill sets and the capacity to take over the control and ownership of our lives. So that's what I think is our biggest issue that we're striving for, is to put in place our way of thinking, our worldview of how we want to live our lives. We don't need somebody determining what we do and cannot do from cradle to grave. We need to have the empowerment of our people to chart our own destiny.
Mr. Martin, I know you tried when you were in public office to do a bit of a game changer in terms of some of what has just been talked about by the chief. I know as somebody who's in the media, I'm inclined more to hear about sort of bad news stories. Even just before I left the radio station today, what's in the news? A little tiny story, but it's about some Aboriginal protesters in Caledonia being on the highway. I'm not sure what it was about. I don't know how long it lasted, but that's the kind of story that, you know, that now that I'm in the media that I see more so than what I just heard the chief saying about people wanting to have the same aspirations as every other Canadian and so on. How do we address that? Is that a barrier? The fact that people consume, Canadians, other Canadians, consume just the news that is kind of the controversial news as opposed to what you just heard as a very human statement from the chief?
Yeah, I think it is, John. I think it is one of the barriers. The both of us, being former politicians, know that press is usually a big barrier. Lee, says he.
I used to think that way, but
no, I'm. I just thought I'd remind you of the truth. I think there are a couple of things to pick up really on what the chief says. First of all, think about this. The Grand Chief, in front of all of us, found it important to be able to say that fundamentally what the First Nations want is to be able to control their own destiny. That he had to make that point in this room is pretty significant. I mean, the fact of the matter is that nobody else would stand up here and say, I want to control who I am, what I'm doing. And yet the chief felt that he had to do it, and there's a reason for that. In 1876, we passed the Indian Act. The Indian Act essentially said that every single member of the First Nations is accountable fundamentally to the Minister of Aboriginal Affairs for everything from birth to death. They imposed upon them a set of restrictions and a set of control that if anyone in this room had it imposed upon them, we would be out in the streets. And that's what they have lived. What the chief simply said was, we want to control our own destiny. We can run our schools, we can run our hospitals, we can do this, let us do it. And for God's sake, for 150 years, we've not allowed it to happen, and we're still fighting. So that's one thing. The second thing is, which the chief did not go into, but there are fundamental differences. And I think it's about time, and we were talking about it at our table, I think it's about time that we start to understand some of the differences. The chief mentioned very briefly his worldview. Well, there is a different worldview. Aboriginal Canadians, the First Nations, are far more spiritual than the rest of us. We've lost most of our spirituality. They have kept it. Their tie to the land is not something artificial. The tie to the land is real. The land means something to them in a way that I certainly could not explain to you. It took me a long time to understand this, and what we should really do is, first of all, not ask people like me to explain what the tie of the land is. You haven't done it. You should. But you haven't done it. But that tie to the land is something that is deeply spiritual that most of us do not understand, and that gives you a worldview. And when they look at something, they look at something from as a whole, as opposed to segmenting it in their own minds. It's a very different perspective, but it's an interesting perspective because I'll tell you something, it's a perspective that you will now hear from the leading environmentalists in the world, the scientists, and you will now hear from scientists as they begin to look at the Earth. And so I think that what has to happen here, and as we go ahead, is that we really make the attempt, those of us who are not First Nations, to understand the great strength, the great perspective of the First Nations worldview. You don't have to agree with it, but it's pretty hard not to. But the one thing that'll be very clear to you is that it's a different intuition, it's a different insight than what most of us have. And until we do that, I don't think we're going to succeed. When I first went to Japan 40, 50 years ago, when Japan was on the rise, the one thing that they did, they sent me there to study the Japanese investment business. I took 6 weeks. They took 6 weeks for me to understand what the Japanese thought, how the Japanese thought, saw the world. Explain to me why they would take a young man who was going to Japan and they would give him 6 weeks before he went to Japan to explain how the Japanese saw the world. And for God knows how long, we have been sending Canadian business doing resource development on to traditional lands without spending 5 minutes trying to figure out what the people who live in that land think. I think that's the fundamental issue that we've got to face up to.
Or for that matter, I think a lot of the schools now, and Minister David will know this, have programs where they'll send kids out, and rightly so, to farms for a day or two to understand how farms work. But I don't know that we have a lot of programs that would send kids out to visit First Nations communities to learn about that at the same time, because if you started at that age, you might have a better time. David, the chief mentioned jurisdiction. And, you know, without getting dragged down, I mean, I remember, for example, I mean, I spent more of my time than perhaps I should have relative to the Southern Ontario First Nations community, visiting some of the remote communities, which were even more troubled in some respects. And I remember being in Attawapiskat with all the problems they were having, and them explaining to me the school had been closed for a long period of time. I forget what it was, 2 or 3 years, because of a fuel leak. And they hadn't built a new school. I think it's now being done or done. But they also made a great point of talking to me about the fact that education, for example, which is handled by that very same kind of bureaucracy the Prime Minister just referred to, you know, was remote, it wasn't tied into the rest of the education system. But is jurisdiction and the fact that everybody sort of points fingers at one another, in fact, something that you've even been able to see as a relatively new minister to this, I'll say confuses things at least, or in perhaps blunter terms, stands in the way of achieving the kinds of things that the chief talked about?
I think the great challenge that First Nations have is to raise the awareness of everybody else in the province, in the country. Everybody here in this room has some appreciation of the nuances of the life on First Nations and where First Nations fit into our constitutional arrangements, and we all know that the First Nations, there's a reason they're called First Nations, because they were here first, thousands and thousands and thousands of years ago. I was very struck by the map that was on the display, and the map in the and the program. And when you look at the map, First Nations territory covers all of Ontario that's shown on that map. I want to tie that back to my comment about, I think, one of the great challenges in First Nations, which would help First Nations and help us deal with education and health and all the other challenges, is somehow raising the awareness of the average person out there in the street that just doesn't understand what First Nations means, doesn't understand the challenge, doesn't understand the extent of First Nations in Ontario. I'll tell you a story that'll drive the point home. In my office, on the wall, I have a huge map of Ontario, and on this column on the side are listed the names of 133 First Nations, and then they're all plotted on the map. And when you sit back and look at the map, you say, oh my God, the First Nations is Ontario. And the point is that I've had many people visit my office who have no familiarity with the world of First Nations. And I take them over to them, and they'll ask me, they say, well, you're the Minister of Aboriginal, what do you do? What's Aboriginal Affairs all about? What's First Nations all about? And so on. I take them over and I show them the map on the wall. I run down the list of the 133 First Nations and I show them where they're plotted out on the map. And you know, I can say to a person, not one of those people had any appreciation of the extent of First Nations in Ontario. And when they see that, they sit back and they kind of gasp and they say, this is an enormous undertaking. And then that leads into a discussion about the challenges on education, health, political arrangements, and so on. But I challenge you to go out in the street out here in the corner and stop 100 people and ask them about First Nations, and they have no sense of it.
that may speak to a different part of education. I was a history student, and I can tell you I learned more from being in politics and visiting some of these communities and so on than I ever learned as a Canadian history student about First Nations. I learned, it wasn't because I didn't study or that I didn't go to class, I did, honestly, but it was because even in my Canadian history courses, there was precious little said about the First Nations. It just wasn't part of what they taught.
So just to follow up on that, I had a conversation with the Premier Wynne about the map in my office and the reaction to people who had no familiarity with First Nations issues, the reaction to that map. And as a result of that conversation, the Premier and I and the Minister of Education, Liz Sandals, are now sending out that map to each of the 5,000 plus elementary and high schools in Ontario with an instruction to post it in a prominent place and have kind of a school assembly about it. Because that's the only way that we're going to raise the level of awareness on these issues.
So education is something that has come up, and Mr. Martin, I wanted to start with you on this one. We heard the chief say that First Nations people want simply what, and again, why this would come as a surprise to us, I don't know, that they'd want for their children and for themselves exactly what every other Canadian would want, access to quality education and training and opportunities later on in life for gainful employment and being able to make a contribution. So narrowing it down now to talk about those, you know, quite specific aspirations that Aboriginal people have like everybody else, what are the main barriers, do you think, standing in the way, or have we covered that? I mean, is it the same thing we're talking about, which is, you know, going through the list, a lack of information, a lack of education, the jurisdictional issues, the historical context within which all of this has been placed, which has not been changed? What are those barriers?
Well, obviously, the history of colonization is a huge barrier. The fact that the mantra of colonization was essentially to say, everything we believe, we the dominant power, everything we believe is good, and everything you believe is bad. You press that down people's nose for a while, but the fact is, of course, that the First Nations fought back, and they wouldn't accept it. And that's why we brought in the residential schools. The purpose of the residential schools was assimilation, it wasn't education, and it's done huge damage, which we feel today. But, you know, unfortunately, that was done by previous generations. We didn't do it. It's easy for us to hide behind that and say, well, that's fine that our forefathers did that and it's not our fault. The single biggest problem on reserve education today is the fact that the federal government pays anywhere from 30 to 50% less per capita to fund a school on reserve than the provincial governments in the country do to fund their schools off reserve. Now you think about what that means. Primary and secondary school education in this country is a right. It is a free universal good. It is the reason that most of us are here. If not all of you, certainly your parents or your grandparents got themselves into whatever position it was that you could afford to come to the four seasons, because in fact they went to a free grade school and a free high school. Well, the fact is that if you go to a high school on a reserve, which is 10 miles away from a provincial school in Ontario, the chances are that your teachers will not be as qualified or very high, properly, because they have been underpaid. The fact is that you will not have a gym, you will not have extracurricular activities, you will not have computer or science courses, you absolutely will not have courses with kids with special disabilities, and in probably 40% of the schools, you will be going to a school that nobody in this room would send their children to. Now that's the fact is, now think about it. This is Canada in the 21st century, the youngest, the fastest growing segment of our population, and we are deliberately, as a country, underfunding their schools. And if they properly fund their schools, it's because they have to take it from their healthcare budget. You know, for God's sake, if this was done in any other country, we would storm. You know, people would storm out. I'll tell you a story. It doesn't relate just to schools, but it relates to the unfairness with which we as Canadians are proceeding in terms of our responsibility to those who inhabit this land with us. One time, the president of the World Bank had to be in an African country. I'm not going to identify the country. And the president of the World Bank said, since you're going to be there, would you go visit a community? because this community is in this community is the country has asked for a big loan from the World Bank, grant from the World Bank for community development. Would you go and see this one village that they have talked about, which they put a lot of money to see how they've done? So I get to the country. I had to be there anyway. That's why I did it. Got into a Jeep. It was supposed to be an hour's drive. It took me about 4 hours, 5 hours to get there. And it's like in Toronto. And I...
that's only to go 2 blocks.
I went to the village. It was god-awful. It was the most miserable place I've ever seen, in just in terms of sheer misery. So I went back the next day, and I walked into the president of the country was there with his cabinet. And I walked in. They said, "Well, Mr. Martin, you've seen the village. Are you going to authorize? Are you going to recommend to the World Bank to give us the loan?" And I said, "Mr. President, I will do no such thing. I've been up in that village. You're supposed to have put hundreds of millions of dollars into it. You haven't put a bloody penny into it. I'd like to know where the hell the money went. But I tell you, it is without any doubt the most miserable place I have ever been." Young man whose assistant sat standing beside him leans down and whispers something into his ear. And then the president says to me, standing on the high ground, "Mr. Martin, my assistant would like to say something to you." And I said, "Yes." And he said, "Mr. Martin, I went to McGill. I went to McGill for 4 years. I spent 2 years working up north. I know," and he named Grassy Narrows. He said, "I've been to Grassy Narrows, and it's worse than anything you've seen." And he was right. And I didn't know what to say. That's Canada 6 years ago.
I just said to one of the chiefs tonight that when I went to Attawapiskat, if you took a group of people, including some people in this room who just hadn't been before, and you kept them blindfolded on the plane on the way up, and they got off the plane, and you said, "Where do you think you are?" And you told them the province of Ontario, they wouldn't believe you in Canada. And they wouldn't believe you. So I think I'm glad you told that story. So, Minister, what with respect to the specific business of education and training and how it's a gateway to the kinds of aspirations being fulfilled that the chief talked about, what is the province of Ontario? What role can the province play? What role is the province playing in trying to address what, you know, you've heard described, well, and
Paul,
we all know is...
Sure. John, the problem isn't... The problem is the on-reserve schools, which are in federal jurisdiction. The provinces are doing their best to compensate for this.
I understand. And
let me just say, the problem—that's
where the funding shortfall.
Let me just say
the
problem of the provinces. Let's take a look. You know this. You know this very well. Let's take a look at the funding. What is the funding? What funding does Ottawa have to do that rises? A little bit of old age pension, okay? A little bit maybe of other things that are going to cost a bit of money. But really, nothing's driving a federal deficit. But what happens in the case of the province? They have got health care, they have got education, and they have got the cities. Okay? For God's sake, what's happening right now is that the federal government is asking the provinces, for heaven's sakes, to spend money in their jurisdiction because they won't spend it to give Aboriginal First Nations decent education. This is not a provincial issue. This is a federal issue.
And Paul's quite right. The differential is, he said, 50%. So maybe on reserve, which is the federal responsibility, they might spend $2,000 or $3,000 per student per year. The provincial government will spend $5,000 or $6,000 per student per year. And I was visiting one of the First Nations communities in the north, and this was a story that I heard. A mother and father, two or three children, I believe, and they told me that they were feeling great stress and pressure and so forth because they, in fact, recognized that getting the best education for their children was the way to raise their children's lives up. But this was their choice. They could keep the three children, two or three children, on reserve in a school, and it's a substandard school because if you're spending $2,000 or $3,000 per student per year as opposed to five or six, teacher quality, building quality, teaching materials, all of that stuff suffers. And the parents faced this very difficult choice, as did their children. We would like to keep our children at home and raise them as a family and have them with us every day. You can send them down the street, down the road a few miles. They'll go to a school that's getting $5,000 or $6,000 per student per year. They're going to get a better education, They're going to get better opportunities, and we want to do that for the children. The children felt sad having to leave the family. The family felt sad having to leave them. Now, how can we justify putting parents and children in a position where they have to make that choice? They want to stay in the bosom of their family, they're going to suffer educationally. If they want an education to raise themselves up and to get all the benefits that an education, they've got to tear themselves away from their family. You know, that is so unfair, that is so sad, that we have got to stop, we've just got to stop it somehow. So how do we go about that? Well, I talked to my federal counterparts in Ottawa, and they say, on-reserve education is our business, off-reserve is your business, and never the twain shall meet. That's a barrier that somehow I got to break down. We've got to break down.
Well, Chief, you know, last words to you on this. What is the nation doing about this, and what? How do you respond to the comments heard from your two fellow panelists? Because you were the one that described at the outset, right from your heart, about the aspirations and including education and training. And how do we deal with this? What can you do, but what can the governments do
It's very clear in our minds what we must do. We've been embarking on the development of our own education authority. We want to be able to, as our chief operating officer was saying in the opening remarks tonight, tell our story. History didn't begin in this country when one of the explorers got lost and come down the St. Lawrence and over in the Great Lakes there. That's why they call it history, his story. It's not our story. So, creating awareness. We've been, asking, both levels of government, to put appropriate curriculum into the schools that tell the story of the First Nations in this land. We've been talking for years about culturally relevant materials. It's starting to happen, but the answer comes from us delivering our own systems. We've had these outside jurisdictions and agencies coming in, constantly trying to, tell us how we need to operate our communities. We've developed a system in the Anishinabek territory that has clusters of geographically suited communities that work in a natural setting with each other to deliver education services. This has been bottled and fashioned by the education experts, the parents, the leaders in our communities. It's not something that was top-down approach where some of my staff developed this thing. This has been 19 years of work has gone into developing a model that's going to deliver education services. We've been told by many, many external professionals and politicians and ex-politicians, that they look at this model. We've been told even by various ministers of Indian Affairs that this is a model that we should be promoting right across the country. But guess what? Another barrier comes up because they've got legislation now that they want to try and ram down our throats in terms of a whole new education model that they haven't consulted us or talked to us about how education services should be delivered in our communities. We've got something ready to go. So we're having talks. We're close. We're very close in terms of our negotiations with the federal government. We're getting very good cooperation from our friends here in the province in terms of being very open and flexible to the ideas of looking at revamping how we deliver services. But we've got to have that political will in this country, to believe, like we believe, that we can do the job. And that's the problem. They used to say that the Indian Affairs minister was the great white father in Ottawa, or the prime minister was the great white father in Ottawa. And one of the elders used to say to me, if he's the great white father, this is the worst case of child abuse I've ever seen. And this goes to exemplify the fact that we know how to do the job. We have people with skill sets in every gamut of careers now. Not like in the days when I started out in politics many, many years ago, where you had seasonal employment or you had a job maybe in the ban office. And that was the only game in town. We've now taken over the delivery of services in many, many fields. We have our own police forces. We have our own health care providers. We have our own social workers. We need to move the yardsticks on how we deliver our services in childcare, in our own systems of governance, in our economic development pursuits, and most importantly, in education. You know, history tells you that oppressed people, there's two ways to keep oppressed peoples down. Keep them uneducated and in poverty. Well, guess what, folks? What do you think's happening here in Canada? You know, so that's why we've got to turn this story around.
Just a very brief comment. I suspect one of the reasons I'm here is that I actually know, and I know Walter well, I know the Grand Chief, and spent a fair amount of time. There is more education skills in the Union of Ontario Indians and in what they have got than there is in the entire federal government. The federal government does not have any the federal government does, well, you can clap. It's so rare, in my case. The federal government has no responsibility for education. And as a result of that, there is no one in Ottawa who has any education skills. There are huge education skills in the Union of Ontario Indians. And what's happening is that people up there who don't know are trying to tell people down there who do. People up there who don't know education are trying to tell them. People up there who don't know the culture are trying to tell them. People who don't know the traditions are trying to tell them. That's the problem the chief is fighting with.
They've never been to our community. How do they know us? They wouldn't get to our community unless they had a GPS.
Or we're making robocalls.
David, this has been sort of circling around a little bit. One of the other issues when, again, it comes to ultimately being gainfully employed, which is where we started. And we hear a lot about how we have jobs without people and people without jobs, and there's a kind of that gap that exists that people are, I guess, trying to deal with in governments as best they can. We hear a lot about a shortage of skilled trades and labor. The government of Canada seems to be talking more about immigration as a solution to this, and I just wonder, putting it to you, is there a possibility, recognizing some of what Mr. Martin said earlier on about where responsibility lies, is there anything that can be done by way of quality education and training for First Nations that could represent more of a made-at-home solution for these shortages we hear about, for this mismatch of skills and jobs in the country, in the province?
Yeah, that's a very good question, because in the opening remarks from the lectern just before dinner, it was pointed out that 40% of First Nation community, First Nation members, are under the age of 25. That's a huge pool of young people about to start out on their careers, be they teachers, electricians, engineers, hospital workers, and so on. So there's a huge pool of people there that we can draw on. And it seems to me that those youth, those 40% under 25, who are First Nations and have been here, as the Grand Chief said, for thousands and thousands and thousands of years, well before the explorers came down the river, lost, as you say, surely we should be able to find some way to give that pool, that talented pool, first dibs, if you will, on these jobs that we're trying to fill in Canada. So if we take that decision and we say we should have some mechanism to give those 40% under 25 sort of a first crack at all of these jobs that the federal government is searching overseas to find people to fill, we start with that premise. Then the next premise is all governments and First Nations have to develop mechanisms to, in fact, give those under 25s the skill and the training and the education so that they can fill those demands for job. I think that's the way to go. The government should recognize some mechanism to give young First Nations a first chance, if you will, at some of these jobs before they're searching overseas. And the corollary to that is we've got to provide the skill sets and the trainings so they can meet those jobs. Imagine if we could tap into that pool and have all of those people highly skilled and working. That's what we should be doing.
Now, when you use the we there, and I don't mean this in any sort of provocative way, but when you use the we there, are we back in the same sort of conundrum that has been described up here by everybody tonight, which is that we doesn't necessarily mean these are things that you could be doing? When I say you, your government could be doing, or our province?
By the we, I mean the collective we. The provincial government has things that it can do to address these problems. The federal government does. The First Nation leadership does. The First Nation leadership understands in their fingertips, in their blood, in their gut, they understand the problem. They have got some great advice and some great ideas how to solve this problem and how to empower First Nations youth and empower the First Nation leadership. So we should all be addressing this problem.
Chief, I mean, is there a way to make this happen? That, I mean, Minister makes statements of good intention. They sound very sensible, but yet these things don't seem to happen.
Well, it comes down to the political will, and we talk about the plight of First Nations trying to build schools or fix up schools that really shouldn't even be inhabited by our students. I hear the government built 20 schools in Afghanistan. Where did they find the money to build 20 schools in Afghanistan? This is what is really really puzzling. We have the plan. I think that's the key here. We have a plan, and we do not need some other experiment, that hasn't been tried or tested, that hasn't been vetted with our people. If you want to have something work, you have to take ownership of the issue. You have to take responsibility for the outcomes. That's what we're saying we want to do. And when we're developing our own processes for how we want to, determine our destiny, develop education systems for our children, this is what the answer is. It's not, again, somebody coming along and saying, we know what's best for you. 150 years of this hasn't worked. When are they going to stop trying to do things in a way that does not work in our communities when we have the answers?
A couple of points, two of them on topic, one of them not, possibly. First of all, what the chief is saying is, for God's sake, let us control it. Graduation rate on reserve is from high school is about 35%. Graduation rate in Nova Scotia, among the Mi'kmaq, is 85%. You know why? They are the only group who effectively control their own education. They're only First Nations group. I mean, the fact is, if you control it, and if they're your kids, you're going to do a better job than if you're, 500 miles away. That's what the chief is saying, and I think that he's dead on. And I know the minister would agree with that. Second thing is, this is about partnerships. So we got to reach out. There has to be a reach out to partnerships. Has to be a reach out to business. Fundamentally, it isn't good enough to say, we're opening a plant tomorrow, and you guys aren't ready, therefore I'm going to hire immigrants. You say, I'm going to open my plant in 3 years, and I'm going to train you for 3 years, so that you're ready when the time comes. That's the next thing. The second thing, there are a number of other partners. The operating engineers are here. They're right there. I mean, the unions can play and are playing a tremendous role and want to play a tremendous role in this whole area. To empower the unions so that the unions can play the work in terms of kinds of trades and apprentices, that's where you've got to go. But if I could just give a slightly longer answer, there is something else that isn't here. It is control. It is financing. But, John, the first set of questions that you put, when you ask the chief about what are you about, where are you going, I think, and what the awareness issue, I don't think that you can just talk about awareness and then get into education, or talk about awareness and get into jobs. The lack of awareness of non-Aboriginal Canadians is so overwhelming that it colors absolutely everything that happens. And so young members of a First Nation wanting to get a job and working with people who do not understand where they're coming from, do not understand that there are slight differences, which are very good, is huge. And it's a problem in the schools. And so where we're talking about on-reserve schools, could I just give a little story about an off-reserve? Would you mind for 1 minute? I don't have anybody here from Winnipeg, but there's a school called Gordon Bell in Winnipeg. Gordon Bell is and this is the kind of thing that has to happen. So this is an off-reserve school. Gordon Bell is a school with about 20% First Nations and Métis. The other 80% are, I think there are 54 different languages spoken there. Very few Smiths or Jones. Everybody from everywhere else. It's an immigrant, largely immigrant population. One of the huge things that people are very worried about, and they were very worried about at this school, is that, well, these kids won't understand their history, and how is this mix going to work? And there were a lot of problems. So the school really began to work on the problems. The school themselves began to had the kids get into dialogue sessions, had young Afghanis talk to young members of the First Nation, had young members of the First Nation. So what happens, I'll just tell you the story. I want you to picture this. We have a business course I go in, and when we introduce the business course into the school, I went into the school, and normally I address the student audience. And so when I walk in to assemble all of the kids in the high school, and as I walk by, there's a group of 10 young women student drummers, First Nations drummers. I'd never seen women drummers before. They were drummer, and they were terrific. And I was touched and talked to them. And then I turned around, and it was about to go, and all of a sudden I heard this massive noise, and I looked over, and there, starting up, were 24 African drummers. These are kids from Ethiopia. And suddenly I realized that the women drummers, Aboriginal, were playing in sync with the African drummers, and the African drummers were playing in sync with the young women. It was phenomenal. I normally then get questions from the kids, and they all line up. I was so touched by what happened here that I said, when the time came from the questions, I said, I'm not going to answer any questions. I'm going to ask you questions. First student who got up there was a young girl. She was Chinese. I said, what do you think about all these Aboriginal kids? And she looked at me and she said, Mr. Martin, I don't know what you're talking about. These are my friends. And I said, well, tell me about their history. And she gave as good a history of Aboriginal Canada in about a 5-minute answer as I ever heard. Next kid was an African kid. I said, well, what do you think about all these Aboriginal people here? And he said, these are the people here, Mr. Martin, long before Europe people came here. And he took me on, and I went to live in hell. And it was gone. And the third kid then was a young, and he said, Mr. Martin, these are my friends. They have stories to tell from where they came from, Mr. Martin, that I don't know if any of us could survive, but let me tell you what's going to build this country. And he went on and talked about how, they said, my ancestors, this is the young First Nation, my ancestors welcomed your people. I welcome them. I want to build with them. It was one of the most touching exhibitions I've ever seen. If we did that in our public schools across this country, then there wouldn't be a First Nation kid who would feel that he couldn't go into any job in the country and feel at home. That's what we got to do, is break down the silos, and that's more important than anything we could talk about. But we're not going to break down the silos unless, as the chief said, he can control his own destiny and his people's destiny, and until they're properly funded. That happens, I'll tell you, there is not a country in the world that's going to touch us.
So John.
One of the things I'd just like to share a comment as well on this is that, you know, we got to keep repeating, we got to stop repeating the same ways of how we do business. You know, I'll give you a little example of a situation that occurred to me when I was the chief of my own community. They were promoting tourism in the area where I come from on Manitoulin Island, and they had these cruise ships coming in, and they had a Mountie there that was greeting the passengers from around the world coming to the island. And the tourism person comes up to me, he said, you know, Don't you think it would be more appropriate if one of you chiefs came here and in full regalia and welcomed the people off the ships when they come here? And I said, we only made that mistake once. But that is how she thought engaging us or involving us should happen. She didn't come to say to us, you know, would you be interested in organizing cultural activities, creating some employment in the area in the tourism sector, so that we can go around. So what we ended up doing is we ended up taking over that whole tourism sector and delivering, you know, cultural seminars, facilities, and everything. We had to take and do it right. So that's just an example of a different perspective of how, you know, you can engage us. You know, it was kind of a, she sat there a little stunned for a moment because she was wondering what the heck I was talking about when I said we only made that mistake once. But she caught on.
Final word on this question before we go to the last question from you, David.
Well, you know, we've come back to this thing, this issue of the awareness. The awareness of the, there should be an awareness of the non-First Nation community that the best solutions are found on the individual First Nations, all 133 of them, because on each of those nations, they're living the problem, the issues, they're close to it, they see the solutions. So the challenge is for the non-First Nation community to provide the resources and the assistance that we can and have the confidence to turn it over to you, Chief, because you've got the confidence to develop the system and you know the best system. You'll know what works, what doesn't work. I think that's what we have to do. We have to work on this awareness and we have to have the confidence to say, here are some resources, you devise the plan, you run with it, and I think we'd all be the better for it.
You know, I'll just say respectfully before we move on to the last question of this part of the evening, that I'm not sure how much effort is made at reaching out to, you know, when I was a business CEO of a big business in Ontario that employed a lot of people and had a lot of customers, I'm sure, who were among the Aboriginal communities too, and inviting, for example, me or anybody like me in that capacity to come to the communities and learn some of this. Even as a media person, you get precious little in terms of and you might say, well, we should be seeking that out, but I just say that, you know, respectfully, because I think there's an opportunity that even things I've heard tonight that I should have learned long before now. I have someone who's in public office for a period of time and as a media person, and you don't know these things, you learn them as you come here. And you're not going to learn it by one visit, but the visits are... And I guess, speaking of which, I heard as I came in tonight talk about, because it's the last item, and we'll turn to you first, if we could, Grand Chief, which is... obviously, the First Nations want to participate as well they should in fully and completely in the opportunities presented by our resource development in the country. And I heard referred to as I came in that some of the proponents, the people who are in the business, are going first just to sort of deal with their projects and not bothering to stop by and have a discussion. And maybe their idea, too, is that somebody should show up in full regalia to greet the visiting delegations. But, you know, in the end, it's a very genuine challenge and a huge opportunity for the First Nations people to take a full role in the resource development. What is it going to take by way of things that can be done by the First Nations themselves, but also by the partners in government and business to make this actually a reality?
Yeah, there's not just one quick fix to this. There has to be, an understanding and awareness created in the school system. You know, we have to start engaging industry. We spend a lot of time, going and talking to the schools, talking to universities and colleges. We've been doing cultural orientation sessions at teach-ins in around the area. But I think, in terms of the bigger picture, there are so many approaches that we need to take to create awareness. I think part of it is that, we can't just learn something, in a one-off session. There has to be lifelong learning. Like when I was going to school elementary and post-secondary levels, you know, we were taught a lot of American history, a lot of British history, and very little even about Canadian history, let alone First Nations history. So I think it's really incumbent upon ourselves to create that kind of a true picture of what really is going on in this country. So when industry comes, or even government comes into our territories, you know, that should be the first stop, you know, to get an understanding. You know, that map, you know, that you saw there, and the map that you have in your office, you know, should be the first signal to say, you know, where are we, you know, trying to do business? You know, when a proponent comes and they want to do business and they go to get a permit for government, you know, we're the last to be consulted as an afterthought, and only because we now have court rulings that say we have there's a duty to consult and accommodate. If that wasn't there, and as has been the case in the past decades, you know, industry wouldn't be talking to us at all. But the reality of the situation is that you know, the treaties are still intact. We have constitutional protection under Section 35. We have United Nations Declaration. All these things, and a number of something like to the tune of over 170 Supreme Court rulings now, dictate that in terms of dealing on First Nations territory across this territory, First Nations have to be consulted and accommodated. Now, when you talked about earlier, Minister Zimmer, about you know, how we need to put in place mechanisms, you know, that when you know, you're going to go and engage somebody, that you need to, you know, put in place these particular policies of maybe before you go and approach you know, another part of the world to bring in a workforce here, that you should be talking to us first. We're saying the same thing to industry. We're saying the same thing to government. You know, we're there. We've got a strong and able workforce ready to go. We need to build that up. We need to build capacity. That's why we're trying to promote our own education system to achieve success, so that we'll have those talented individuals to go up. We have a lot of talented young people in our communities already, but we need to increase the pool. We have such a large workforce that we have to find long-term sustainable employment for, just for all the reasons I stated in my opening comments.
John, I'd like to make an observation and pose a question, because it's been troubling me for some time. And we have, four politicians, in fact, here on the table, but I'm going to leave you just out of this for a second, Grand Chief, but we have three elected politicians, provincially and federal.
Actually, I was defeated, Dave, but never mind.
Sorry?
I said I was actually defeated, and I'm out of it now, but that's okay.
But you were elected. You were elected. But it's often struck me, and I ask myself this question, to the extent that in this past 15 or 20 years, we've made progress, or progress has been made in Ontario, in Canada, in terms of recognizing First Nation rights, and so on, the duty to consult, empowering First Nations, they're doing all the things that they're doing now, to raising the awareness of First Nation rights and so on. You know, all of that has come not from politicians, not from elected provincial governments, not from elected federal governments, but it's come from the judges, from the courts. And you think back, Chief, you referenced 130 something decisions, and there are, you know, a couple of dozen really ones that stand out. For instance, the duty to consult decision, which said to governments and business, you know, if you're going to undertake some activity and it has an effect on a First Nation, you better sit down and get them involved in what you're going to do and get them to sign on. You know, and I ask myself, so why didn't that sort of idea or initiative come from the elected political people, federally and provincial? Aren't we fortunate that we had judges sitting up there, independently appointed for life, who somehow, they recognized this issue, they empowered the First Nations, it wasn't the politicians. Why is that?
As the person who knows the least, I'll give you my own answer, because I was there for a brief period of time. And that is because it seems to me, from watching this, as if governments, plural, federal and provincial, two that I'm most familiar with, have been entirely 100% of their own destiny, and the governments just are reactive. They wait, they sort of hope things stay quiet, and that everything just sort of goes along. Nobody ever really sort of proposes bold change. I will say Mr. Martin was an exception with something like the Kelowna Accord, but otherwise then the court cases are the only things that ever happen because no one can control the legal process. It's at the, you know, so to me that's...
But what is there about the judge's mind that has got in the mind of the panel of judges to recognize these issues and say...
Well, David, they can't dodge those issues because somebody brings a case to the court, they have to consider it, but maybe Mr.
Now, Paul, you've appointed lots of judges in your day.
Good one.
Supreme Court?
Yeah.
Trial division? Yeah. What do you have? What's your take on
obviously
this?
You're right. The judges have a very important role. The charter plays a very important role in all of this. But the real answer that I think that the courts have gone the way that they have is... Unlike the United States, there was a very important decision in the United States on treaties and agreements of these kind. And the courts in the United States said the treaties will be interpreted according to the circumstances of the time, and the wordings will be strictly interpreted. In other words, what they said was, if you have a medicine chest, then it's in 1850, then it's the medicine chest in 1850. It stops there. And there is nothing further. There was a very early court decision in Canada that said that all of these treaties will be interpreted as living wills. And what that meant is that they will be interpreted in today's circumstances. And so it was that fundamental decision that opened the door for our courts to do exactly what you said, David, and you're absolutely right. It was not the politicians, it was the courts. But the courts then interpreted the treaties, interpreted the agreements, as if in fact they were living documents. And that is why the courts have been able to do what they have done, and I think the point is very well taken. I would just say one other thing. I would like to just say one other thing. I don't think there's any doubt in terms of natural resource development. There's a bit of more interpretation that's going to have to be done on the duty to consult before it's finalized and before it makes complete sense. And the courts are going to continue to play a role. It would be very nice if the politicians could play an equally enlightened role. But you know, and we just better face up to this. Not only are Aboriginal Canadians, and therefore obviously the First Nations, the youngest and the fastest growing segment of our population, but that number doubles when you think that in terms of where the natural resources are, they are more than the youngest and the fastest growing in where the natural resources are. They are overwhelming, and they are going to become an incredibly dominant population in most of these areas. And anybody who thinks that under those circumstances that we are going to develop our natural resources and with a pre-colonial or a colonial fervor is whistling Dixie. And it isn't, and I don't want to get into a lot of detail, but it isn't going to be doesn't have to be the politicians, and it doesn't have to be the courts that are going to decide that. And that's something that we should understand, and the politicians should bloody well understand it. What they want to do is to see this country develop properly.
Grand Chief, last word on economic development, and then I gather that Chief Isidore Day wants to come up and ask what will be the final question on this segment. So last word to you.
It's
in this
kind
question.
Of ironic, you know, that we're looking to the more modern decisions of the court you know, the way that the United Nations Declaration has recognized our rights and whatever. And yet we're actually in the very year of celebrating, commemorating the Royal Proclamation that actually laid out those fundamental relationships between our nations and a government-to-government relations. And the problem we had is that when, after Canada became a country in 1867, they introduced this thing called the Indian Act around a decade or so later, that changed that relationship to more of an administrative role as a way for the Indian agents to do end runs around our rights and start taking land for development, dealing it over to industry and if you look in the perhaps with the exception of Mr. Martin, all the rich people in the country today have some of that old money here. If you look back at the history of where that money came from, they were the ones that were related to the Crown's representatives here in this country that were striking these deals that gave them access to the mining territories, gave them access to the forestry to do that end run. So we're saying we got to get back to that government-to-government relationship, that respect for the nations that that Royal Proclamation tried to do. Next year is the anniversary of the Treaty of Niagara that recognized the nationhood of our people. We're still nations. And that's what we're demanding. That's what's going to eventually win the day here. You know, I look at it from a perspective of great optimism. We've got such talented young youth coming onto the scene that's going to replace us guys here very quickly. And they are stronger, and you know, they're more than just angry warriors. They're going to win the day. And our demographics are such. The day is going to come as well, and you're already seeing it in places like Saskatchewan, for example, where the demographics have such a tremendous influence. We've got to get ourselves organized more. You know, we haven't been participating in the Canadian political electoral systems, federally or provincially, that much, but yet we can control a lot of the seats across this country, and in certain areas of the country we can control it significantly. So we've got to look at other ways of leveraging how we affect change. And we're the ones that are going to have to affect that change.
All right. I gather that Chief Isidore Day would like to come up and ask a final question for the panel. Where is the Chief? Come up and do that, and that will bring this part of the discussion to a close. There we are. Mine is all attached to me here. Can you use that one right there? Perfect.
Ooh. Sorry. Good evening. Honored guests. Panel, our organizers, I just wanted to acknowledge the Seventh Generation Charity and Walter and the gang. Let's give them a big round of applause. They did an excellent job here tonight. I'm going to keep this as quick as I can, but I just wanted to reiterate a couple things that were said here on the panel tonight, and I just want to humbly gesture to the chiefs here that I'll speak on behalf of Serpent River, but I'll speak from the perspective of a First Nation chief, because I think what we heard here tonight was, you know, a lot of ideas, perspectives, some good values in terms of the mandates that these gentlemen represent. But when you get into a First Nation community, you know, we're going to go home tomorrow and we're going to be faced with a number of different issues, pressing issues, and again, it's all fine and well that we're hearing these things, but we need some ideas for what are we going to do about it, right? So I just like to suggest here that there's two themes that I heard here tonight as a First Nation chief. One is the issue of jurisdiction, and I think each and every one of you has reflected on that. You supported that idea. But the other issue here that I didn't hear too much about was the fiscal issues. And Mr. Martin, you did speak to those, and there is a fiscal reality in this country, and it's a fiscal reality that does not include First Nations on a lateral level. We are not part of the fiscal configuration in this country. That's one of the issues here that we're faced with, and you can have a policy discussion, you know, till the cows come home, but if you don't start dealing with the fiscal issues, we're never going to be able to advance First Nation jurisdiction. So I just like to maybe also tie into that backdrop that, you know, there was something that happened back in 1867, as the Grand Chief indicated. It was a division of powers. And when you look at something like the Equalization Payment Program, that agreement is set to be renewed next year between the federal government and the provinces. And that's an arrangement, you know, that deals with the issue of avoiding abject poverty in the provinces. Now, if First Nations were part of that configuration and that discussion, I think things would be a little different in this country. And I think that's really the essence of how deep we have to go with this discussion. And I really hope that what we're trying to target here is not just more policy discussion and more discussion around ideals and things that could happen, but there's some real work that needs to happen around who we are as an order of government in this country. It's really about First Nation governments. It's about recognition of First Nation governments. You know, I'm just going to give you a contrast here before I ask my question. And we have a gentleman who was an MP under your regime, Prime Minister, Brent St. Denis. He was a Liberal MP. And he says to me, he says, you know, Isidore, you know, in Spanish, we have a community that has more people than Serpent River. We have a bank, we have a couple schools, we have stores, yada, yada. He said, we have 6.5 full-time employees, where the First Nations have over 80. You have a less of a population. So what you're actually seeing here is a major imbalance with respect to the fiscal attention being given to a First Nation because of the legal context of a First Nation within Canada's legal framework, i.e. under the Indian Act. We're fighting so darn hard that we are getting resources. But what's happening is you have a piece of legislation that's standing in the way. And it's, again, this thing called the Indian Act. And the filter of all of our activity and the work that we do is based on somebody else's laws and somebody else's regime over our lives. So the whole issue of the fiscal imbalance and the issue of First Nation jurisdiction is really the complex issue that we need to discuss. You know, Canada and the way that it's dealing with First Nations issues today, I think it's very inefficient, it's ineffective, and it's not economical. You know, we have a First Nation process that we're working on in the Anishinabek Nation called constitutional development. So we're recognizing our laws and the issues of our institutions. So there's the whole decolonization that's happening, the way we look at things and the way First Nations are in the relationship in this country. But there's the whole issue of de-entrenchment that has to happen. De-entrenchment of the Indian Act and the implementation of First Nation governments. So my question to the panelists here are, what do we need to fundamentally do? Okay, what can we do? If there's one thing that you can leave us here tonight, what is it that governments need to recognize, i.e. we need to become part of the fiscal framework in this country? And what do First Nation governments need to do to help expedite advancing First Nation governments? Because you know what? It's not happening fast enough. But the demands from our young people, they're screaming and they're saying, you know, we're getting educated, you know, but what's happening is we're having to leave our communities and go work over there because there's no work here because of this Indian Act. So it's really an issue of the fiscal issues and jurisdiction. So what can we do fundamentally to move the yardsticks on First Nation jurisdiction?
Thank you, Chief. David, can I turn to you first to answer? I guess there were sort of two perspectives asked for there, one from the standpoint of governments and others, and then from the First Nations.
Well, I think a piece that perhaps we've talked about, you've left out in your question is, I mean, ultimately, as the Grand Chief has said, the demographic pressures that are building in the First Nation community, you've given Saskatchewan as the example. I referenced earlier, as the speaker before dinner referenced, 40% of the First Nation community is under the age of 25. So those demographics, that age group, are, in my judgment, not going to take no for an answer. Not only are they not going to take no for an answer, but they are going to drive some solution. I think we need to sit down and give a serious think to reorganizing how we do business at that level.
Ms. Martin.
We discussed a lot of things here today. The need to control one's own destiny. We've talked about the Indian Act, and these are all incredibly important issues. But the fact of the matter is that in terms of the ability to control your own destiny, a group of people who never heard of the Indian Act, don't care about the Indian Act, never heard much about the treaties, and don't really understand what they are, that message is only going to go so far. But if the chief has one message, which is, why is it Canadians living there get twice as much money for their education per capita as Canadians living there? Why is it people living there get 25% more for their welfare than people living there? Why is it people living there get substantially more money for health care and all of the other services than the people living there? I'll tell you, Canadians will be outraged. So if you were to, if you're asking me my advice, I would just go out there and say, if what you really want is to have the fastest and the youngest growing segment of your population without a high school education, well, you're well on the way to do it. I will produce you PhDs and physicists and everything else you want. And you'll get it, and you'll win, because Canadians will support you. But you've got to keep it simple, and you've got to keep it direct. And if you do that, I think you'll win this thing hands down. That's what I would do.
Well, I believe what Mr. Martin has said is correct. But I think the other part of it is, I think there has to be respect. You know, to the three orders of government that are in this land, there has to be this jurisdictional wrangling sorted out. And, you always hear the question, well, what is it you people want? You know, there's the Nielsen Task Force report, there's the Penner report, there's the Royal Commission on Aboriginal Peoples, the Kelowna Accord, which I worked on. We've been studied to death. We've been telling the governments the solutions. The Kelowna Accord was a wonderful document that would have gone a long ways to addressing all these issues. We've talked about that, changing the fiscal arrangements, of us dealing, in terms of transfers, directly, to our nations, as opposed to a government department administering a fund with so many strings attached that you're handcuffed to try and do anything. That's this Indian Act again. So, we've had even attempts by the government, and I'm not sure if this was during your term and Mr. Martin or not, but there was an initiative called Gathering Strength. That was supposed to really start to bring out the empowerment of First Nations. Well, that document's gathering dust. So, this is the types of things that's going on. So go back to that political will again. Here in Canada, we're a reality. We've been here. We have carbon dated evidence dating back to over 15,000 years of existence as land. We're not going anywhere. We don't have any place to go back to. We didn't get off that ship. So the answers are there already. And I think it's, again, to have that political will, to listen to us. We've got the answers. So, now it's time for the political will to sort this stuff out. And yes, the awareness is a big part of it. There's no question about it.
Gentlemen, on that note, I'm going to say thank you to you, Grand Chief, to Prime Minister Martin, to Minister Zimmer, for what I hope you found to be an informative and stimulating discussion, and would that there should be some fruit to come from it in terms of some of these things getting more effectively addressed. Thank you very much. Thank you.